I'd like to start off this evening by thanking all of you here at Chelsea Retirement Community, particularly my good friends John Thorhauer and Hazel Mead for hosting this event. I'm so very pleased to be delivering my fifth State of the City speech in a place that represents the warmth and wisdom of our beloved Chelsea so well. It's a true privilege to be here on this special night, surrounded by a community of dear friends, family, and business owners. Thank you, John. Thank you, Hazel. Before I begin my formal remarks, I would like to once again publicly remember Fred Mills, whom we lost earlier this fall. Fred was a dear friend, and for generations was a shining example of what helps to make our beloved Chelsea so unique and special. Like many of you, our family admired and respected Fred for his integrity, his good humor and civility, and his genuine love of others. His practical example of steady leadership was sought out in almost every level of life here in Chelsea. When our school district needed guidance and business acumen, when neighbors needed friendship or comfort, when churches needed generational stability, or when hospital boards needed the wisdom of his experience. Like so many Chelseaites who have lived their lives for the betterment of others, Fred Mills will be deeply missed. 2014 marks my 10th year of public service to the citizens and families of Chelsea and to their future. And as I have at the end of each of the past 4 years, my privilege tonight is to speak directly to you, the citizens of Chelsea, and provide a report on the progress our city has worked to achieve in the past year. At the city level, our continued practice of employing goals and objectives-based strategic planning continues to benefit the community. In this manner, we set the foundation for what needs to be accomplished to meet the needs of the community in the coming budget year and then stick to the plan. This allows us to be proactive rather than reactive. And this evening, I can report to you without reservation that the state of our city is stronger than it has been at any time in the past 5 years. The protocol in past years has been to take a look at our finances, so taking a look at the city's books is a good place to start. For the fiscal year ended June 30th, 2014, the balance in the general fund continues to be within the city's stated policy objective of 15% to 20% of the general fund operating budget. Due to the challenges of the legislative and economic climate here in Michigan, achieving this level of stability in a consistent manner is truly an outstanding accomplishment. Indeed, for the seventh year in a row, there has not been a raise in city millage rates, nor were there any utility rate increases in fiscal year 2014. Under our leadership team, including City Manager John Hanifan and Administrative Director Kim Garland, the city will continue to be fiscally conservative in both its practices and projections as we look forward to growth of the community and the business environment as well here in Chelsea. Staying with this thought for just a moment, I'm pleased to restate the fact that for the fourth year in a row, the accounting firm of Plant Moran has assigned an unmodified audit rating to the City of Chelsea, signaling the highest level of approval and assurance in the financial standing of our city. These attributes help to form the backdrop for continued positive change in our town, and I would like to share some of the more recent success stories with you here tonight. The sensible redevelopment of existing buildings is both appropriate and necessary, helping to improve the quality of life for us here in the present day and for future generations as well. A splendid example of this is the scheduled sale by the city of the former Bookcrafters building located over on Buchanan Street to Chelsea Milling Company. The city owned this building for a number of years, utilizing it primarily as cold storage. The headquarters for Chelsea Milling Company is directly adjacent to this property, and as the company continued to consolidate their operations, a sale was structured, helping one of Chelsea's landmark businesses continue their heritage of success right here at home. Additionally, two more of our signature service providers continued their growth this year to meet further demand. The Chelsea Community Hospital, now a proud member of the Trinity Health System, will cut the ribbon on their new Comprehensive Cancer Center on December 7th, fully a year ahead of schedule. And just outside this room, we are all witnessing the ongoing growth of facilities at Chelsea Retirement Community's memory care and assisted living residences. America's Midwestern downtowns continue to attract a residential clientele, and at the local level, we see this trend reflected in the current redevelopment of the former Chelsea Police Department site located just down the street. If you've not had the opportunity to take a look at these improvements, I highly encourage you to drive by and enjoy the progress. The developer has built street-level commercial exposure with high-end apartments located just above, and each one of those apartments were leased even prior to construction. This year in Chelsea also saw the loss of a treasured Main Street business as the Merkle family's Wolverine restaurant was sold, while at the same time, pet supply retailer Wags to Whiskers moved into new, larger facilities, allowing their continued expansion for years to come. Focusing on our residential neighborhoods, 2014 saw a renewal of home buying here in Chelsea, both at the Fairways and Heritage Point developments at the north and south ends of town. Home ownership has long been a vital part of the American dream, and this latest investment by Chelsea's newest citizens helps to reaffirm our bright outlook on the local economy. Earlier this fall, the city began the process of reviewing and updating its master plan for the approximate 50 acres of parkland located within our city borders. This updated inventory, combined with a long-range plan, will emphasize the implementation of non-motorized paths to help link Chelsea with other surrounding communities. Keeping the emphasis on quality of life issues for a moment, our town was the recent recipient of a $350,000 Safe Routes to Schools grant that will help improve overall safety for our elementary and middle school students. The engineering and design work will begin this winter, with actual construction to be coordinated in and around the coming school calendar year. Future prospects for redevelopment and reuse of lands located within city's borders go hand in hand with the slow managed growth sought by our neighboring townships as well. Joint work sessions continue with these local governments to promote solutions that benefit all of us. Chelsea's sustained commitment to infrastructure improvements proceeded through the past year with the repaving of Jefferson and Flanders Streets, along with the accompanying upgrades in curb and crosswalk installations. With the community's trust and confidence over the past 5 years, we have achieved a great deal in the area of improved infrastructure, but we are not done. In fact, I believe it is our obligation to do more. So, in closing, my friends, the unique and special life we all cherish here in Chelsea can be clearly seen in the events of just the past few days. On Election Day, November 4th, a heavy turnout for the midterm race cast ballots at voting stations in town to exercise one of the most important of American rights. 2 weeks ago, district championships were celebrated for the Chelsea High School volleyball and football teams, while the boys and girls cross country teams finished 5th and 3rd in the state, respectively. Our annual fall ladies outing, Wine, Women, and Shopping, was held again on November 8th with hundreds participating in the festivities. Area veterans were honored as the city and community partners Chelsea District Library and the American Legion held our 4th annual Veterans Day commemoration, bringing together Americans from every generation to honor those who have served and continue to serve this great nation so proudly. This coming Saturday, a longtime custom resumes as Chelsea's historic home tour will be held. And finally, Chelsea's hometown holidays celebration will officially usher in winter and the Christmas season on December 3rd. Ladies and gentlemen, I look forward to continuing our progress together in another year of cooperation and responsible governing. I thank you for being here this evening and for honoring me with your presence. In the past, it's been customary for me to answer any questions that you might have. It's great to be back here, and I regret the fact that I don't get to see all of you enough, or at least as much as I would like to. If you have any questions at all regarding city policy or goings-on in the city of Chelsea, I would be happy to try and answer them. Yes, sir.
I see they have a city manager type of government.
Yes.
Now, is the mayor a member of the council with a vote then? Is that how it
Yes, sir. Very good. That's a great question. And we have Sherry Albertson here, the mayor pro tem for the city of Chelsea, was kind enough to join us this evening, so she has input, I'm sure, that will be valuable. In Chelsea's form of city government, which is outlined in our city charter, which was put into effect in May of 2004, it in effect is our constitution. Yes, the city council is a group of seven. Each one of us has a vote. My vote does not weigh any more than anyone else's, and I have, frankly, no veto power. So it's a vote of the majority of seven that passes or decides not to pass acts that come before the city of Chelsea. It's a good question. Thank you. Yes, sir. Good evening.
Is there a limit in the length of the times that a mayor can serve?
My wife would answer that question, yes.
What was the question?
I'm sorry, let me repeat the question. The gentleman in front has asked, are there term limits in effect for being the mayor for the city of Chelsea, or for that matter, a council member, planning commission trustee, or anything like that? No, there is not written into the charter at this moment a term limit. And I have my own personal feelings about term limits, but no, there are not. Mm-hmm. Your question reminds me of a saying that was told to me a number of years ago by the lady I've learned so much from and who preceded me as mayor of the city of Chelsea, Ann Feeney. She once said, as part of an ongoing conversation, she said, don't ever think you're indispensable. This is the type of town that if you were to drop dead, there would be capable people stepping over your body before you hit the floor to pick up the reins and lead. And she's absolutely correct. There's that level of talent in this town. That's a great question. Yep, no one says it like Ann. Any other questions whatsoever? Yes, sir. Good evening.
Do you have any new information on the old post office?
Good for you.
Or maybe on the Palmer Ford?
Yes, sir. The question was asked, has there been any new developments on either the Palmer Ford, the former Palmer Ford lot, which is now owned by the city, or the 1930s era post office, the WPA era post office? Yes, we received communications in the last 10 days from one of the owners of the consortium, the company that owns the former Chelsea post office, and the inquiry had to do with an assistance plan that the city put into place a couple of years ago and how it might help them further the redevelopment of that building. It is at the moment planned for a high-end restaurant, or at least that's the character of the current plan, and that was the inquiry insofar as what the city could do to help that company in the past few days. So we hope in my opinion, that's the premier corner in town, and we hope that gets off the ground soon. Those things never go as fast as one would like. Let me turn now to your question about the former Palmer Ford showroom lot, located directly across from City Hall and the Police Department. The city and the Downtown Development Authority and a number of groups of vital concerned citizens went through about a 3.5-year process of structuring designs with the help of expert companies who do that type of thing, assisted the city and the DDA in putting together a series of plans for development of that property over and above what you see now. The financing of that final plan has not yet been carried forward. It's come up for vote once. I'm sure it will come up for vote in some structure very soon. And the city council continues to debate what that will be and how soon it will be something more than it is. We did have a report this week at city council and again this morning at the Downtown Development Authority Board of Directors meeting on the progress that has been made with the Chelsea Farmers Market, which, as you know, meets there every Saturday morning in the spring, summer, and early fall. And they had reported record numbers on almost every category they keep track of. So we think, insofar as a site for something like a farmers market or some downtown central gathering spot, we think that spot is absolutely ideal. Issues such as parking, pedestrian safety, restrooms, if any, et cetera, lighting, green space, all of that, those are details that, while they've been worked on for, as I said, 3.5 years, have yet to come to final decision, but we're working on it very hard. Yes, sir?
Well, bringing back the old post office,
yes.
I had heard about arrestment years ago,
yeah.
And I thought that there was a deterrent because of the parking facility.
I can see.
I thought the parking was rather limited for arrestment type operation.
I think if you're thinking of the parking lot where the mail trucks used to park and we used to go in and get stamps and look at our P.O. box offerings and that kind of thing. I think if you're thinking of that as being the primary parking lot, I agree with you. That would be a very limited situation. I think if you were to ask any of the restaurateurs or for that matter business owners in the city of Chelsea, they would tell you that while parking is vitally important, having parking directly outside the front door of their business is not as critical as one might think. I think there's ample space to park, or at least all of the studies and levels of analysis we've done at the city level and the DDA level tell us that we have not ample parking, and having there, it's always a good problem when there's a parking problem in your town. A parking problem is when there aren't any cars in the spaces. So if you're having a tough time parking in downtown Chelsea, somebody's doing a lot of things right. But I think there is, at the moment, there is considerable parking, and the Palmer lot could be converted into a very large parking lot relatively quickly and very cost effectively, I think, if it came to that. There was someone else in your general vicinity that had their hand up that I didn't come back to. I apologize. Young lady in the yellow.
Are there any possibilities of a second food market in town?
Good for you. The lady in yellow asked about the possibilities of a food market in town or a second market in town. If you've been in this area long enough or grew up here, you remember the days when we had three grocery stores on Main Street. And
meat markets.
Right, and meat markets too, yes. I would come back to the observation of the gentleman who spoke just before you and tell you that to have any type of market, even a small specialty market, there has to be ample parking and parking that moves. By that I mean, I think if you were to ask any of the owners of any of the properties that were formerly grocery stores or markets in downtown Chelsea, they would tell you that they would need an open parking lot where people could come and go with relative ease versus try and find a spot to park where there's also businesses where the cars may be staying for the entirety of the day. And I'm not putting it all on parking, but to answer your question succinctly, we have not seen, nor have we been approached by anyone who would operate a market or a grocery store to provide that type of opportunity in Chelsea, outside of the one that's right outside of what we all know as Polly's. Mr. Miles, how are you, sir?
Good. You?
I'm well. Thanks for asking.
The old theater.
Yes, sir.
If that is something that needs parking, then Palmer Lot would be very helpful to
yes.
all the businesses
yes.
in that area.
Yes, it would be. Yes. There is always a very fine line to walk between what is appropriate parking and I won't use the term hue and cry, but the conversation that will be directed towards City Hall if such discussions come up, say, as a parking lot versus a parking deck. Parking decks, as you know, can move into smaller space and many times hold more cars. Many people don't like the idea of having a multi-tiered parking structure in a town of this size. I can understand that viewpoint. But I would agree with you, and I would do almost anything to see that building after 7 years of beautiful redevelopment have a tenant in it.
What are the prospects of housing development? And if there is a prospect of a large housing development or district, how about the water system?
That's wonderful. That's a great question. That will take the next 30 minutes of my evening. So No.
Done by 8 o'clock.
You're fine. Yes, you're right. You're right. I think Hazel's going to turn the lights off at 8 o'clock, or at least flicker them. You're bringing up a very strong point about anything from having to do with city planning or urban renewal, and that is, how do we get residents in the downtown as well? Because if you have a business downtown and you employ workers, one of the things that you would give your eye teeth for is to have a place for them to live in the general area. One of the things that we track pretty closely is how many of the people that come to work in Chelsea actually live in a zip code that begins with 48, you know, 118. Bless you. And I'm sure they're doing the same things in other cities. I can tell you that right now there is not a vacant apartment in the city of Chelsea anywhere as of last week. I mentioned earlier in my speech that the four new ones that are above the former police department on Middle Street, they were rented before it was ever constructed. The houses that are subdivided into apartments in this town and the actual apartment complexes, the Warren apartments, for instance, they are all rented. There is, and there has begun, as I mentioned here tonight in the formal remarks, there is continuation now of the building out in the second and third phases of Heritage Point, which is on the north side of Chelsea Dexter Road, and the Fairways subdivision, which is over near, which is just south of Old US 12 and west of Freer Road. So that's very good to see. That's the first movement in that direction that we've seen in about 4 to 4.5 years. So that's very encouraging, and as you know, that is a home sales or new home sales or continued building are one of the key economic indicators for forward movement of the local economy. So we're happy to see that. These are great questions. Yes, ma'am. Good evening.
I don't get into downtown Chelsea as often as I would like, but has anything happened with the former hardware store downtown, and is one hardware store enough for Chelsea?
I'm going to take your, forgive me, the lady with the pretty green neck scarf asked about hardware stores. The former Western Auto or Gamble's or Johnson's How To store is currently vacant. It is in the family that owns that building, it's my understanding, is continuing to entertain thoughts of sale, but nothing has been done with it yet. The building or the business immediately to the south of that, which was for many, many years the Chelsea Village Shop or the Village Shop of Chelsea, recently closed and turned right around and reopened as La Maison. If you've not been in that store, I highly encourage you to go in there. They just had their soft opening 2 weeks ago tonight, and it was spectacular. Is there immediate prospects for the former hardware store on Main Street? At the moment, no. But as you've seen with other things, if you've been here long enough, other properties along Main Street, it is simply a matter of time. The last portion of your question had to do with, are there enough, is one hardware store enough for the city of Chelsea? Whenever you open a business that depends on very high frequency foot traffic, like a hardware store or any object retailer, we generally look at market, at the circle of traffic circles is what we call them. And generally what we're referring to is how much competition is there in the area for this business or service or this product, and can the product or service or the location that we're introducing be disruptive to the other businesses that are in the same product line. And if you know the area fairly well, you've got the new Great Lakes Ace Hardware, which used to be ACO, just down the street on Main Street. And then immediately over in Jackson, you've got, oh, forgive me, you've got a Sam's Club and a Lowe's. And then just down on Jackson Road, you have a Lowe's. And there's a Farm and Fleet, or a, is it Farm and, it's not Farm and Fleet, I'm sorry, it's Tractor Supply Company as well. And you've got the Chelsea Lumber Company, which does a lot of hardware business. So we've got, if you were to just talk about places that sell hardware, the types of things that we all go to hardware stores for, You've got four or five very large footprints in that area right now, over and above the Great Lakes ACO. So to answer your, or Ace Hardware rather, to answer your question, in my opinion, yeah, I think one hardware store for this within the boundaries of this community of 5,000 people, yes, I think it's probably enough. Yes, sir.
I do not have another question, which may be a surprise, but I want to commend your emergency vehicles for their prompt response to the needs that we have here at Chelsea Retirement Community.
Thank you. That's very kind of you to say. I couldn't agree with you more. I think it's one of the I think it's one of the keystone attractions for this community in general is our first responders. They are in any community, but they hold a special place in Chelsea because of the proximity of the fire station just down the street, but also here in Valley Ambulance. Part of that, yes, can be attributed to the fact of having a magnificent hospital facility, a nine iron shot away. Since I've started my comments, Melissa Johnson, another member of City Council, valued member of City Council, has joined Ms. Albertson in the audience. Considering her lineage and her dad's work in this town, she probably could tell you a few things about first responders and hospital services. But long story short, that's very, very true. I think this is no secret. About 20% of the city's population are what we refer to as older Americans. I mean, that's why I'm here tonight, speaking to you people. You ask great questions and you're involved and you're engaged. One of the things that that does is bring a permanence and definition to a certain section of town. And when we have first class services like the first responders, whether it's the Chelsea Area Fire Authority or Huron Valley Ambulance or the Chelsea Police Department or any of that stuff, knowing that your call for help, regardless of how large or how small it's going to be, is going to be reacted to immediately, is huge. Not just for you and I who live here, but I mean, if we have family members who come to see us, they need to know and take comfort in the fact that we're safe and that we're looked after. So that's, I can't say enough good things about that, and that's something we hear time and time again, but never enough. Thank you, and I will pass that along. That's kind of you. Yes, sir.
Could you explain to some of us that are less informed about this big debate that's going on, and there's signs all over, especially downtown, about this place out south?
Yes, I'll try and be as objective as I can. I think you're probably referring to the signs that say deny the mine and the possibility of property being purchased immediately to our north for the purposes of excavation of mineral resources or a gravel pit. And so that's what all the activity has been about now for the better part of a year. And one of the more, and you can ask Ms. Albertson and Ms. Johnson their thoughts on this as well, but one of my proudest moments in public service or just in life in Chelsea is to see how vitally important that is to the people who live here, whether they agree with it or not, and most don't for obvious reasons, but how engaged they've become, how organized they've become, how current with the facts and the legislation affecting such things they have become. I will tell you that a long-term solution is being sought and negotiated right now as we speak, in this time period that I'm here, to try and find the resources for that company to continue its operations at that level in another part of the state that wouldn't be so dramatically affecting the economy. To have a facility like that, it's about 159 acres of gravel that would be mined for the better part of 20 to 30 years. And what you would see out there, if you look out there now, the topography of the land to our immediate north would be changed dramatically, along with water tables and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, in a part of the township, in this case, that is zoned rural residential and rural recreational. Now, the next meeting of the zoning board for the affected township the primary affected township has been moved out, I believe, to May. May 8th. So we'll know more then. But it's this has been the biggest thing that we've seen affecting the region in my administrative years. And we're working as hard as we can to bring this to a resolution that's positive for both parties.
I understand it would affect a lot of the traffic up and down Main Street.
Yes, sir, it would. Yes, sir, it would. Yes, sir, it would. If you, not tonight, of course, in this weather, but if you were to sit out for a 24-hour period, you'd see between 16 and 17,000 vehicles move back and forth in front of your eyes in a 24-hour period in Chelsea. Okay, going, coming back, and going. This would add a considerable amount to that traffic, and it would be traffic that would be the type of the legally the heaviest, largest trucks that you can put on the highway or put on any road surface. Okay, and keep in mind Chelsea's Main Street is a Michigan highway, so there's so many hands at this poker game, sir, you can't imagine it, and we're all trying to dance politely. Yes, ma'am. Okay. It is one of the, Melissa, help me out if I step in it here. It is one of the companies owned by the state's, and I think this region's largest road and concrete contractor. So it's, McCoig is the immediate owner of the, is the name rather on the application to purchase the land, correct, for the mine? They are a wholly owned subsidiary of Thompson McCauley, correct?
I'm not sure of the direct lineage, but they're definitely.
Yep, there's a connection there. Yep. Yeah, they're, what they are asking to do is completely legal, and they've done it in other places, and other companies have too. So it's not, what they're doing isn't legally wrong, but it would have dramatic repercussions, not just for those of us here in the room, but for our children and grandchildren for a long, long time. Mm-hmm. Did you have your hand up, sir? Would you like to put your hand up? I'm just kidding. Are there any other questions I can address for you? This has been great. Yes, sir, Mr. Miles.
Years ago, there was a bypass of M-52.
Yes.
Is there any thought of redoing that deal in as much as this mining thing is on the docket?
Yes, yes. The short answer is no. The townships
it's harder now.
Yep, they've changed their zoning laws and their ordinances governing widths of road and cutouts and all types of things that would severely limit the possibilities of being able to do anything like that. And we need to keep in mind that M-52 going south through Chelsea would not be the only point of ingress egress for trucks of that size to that facility. They would be headed out north on 52 to 96, or someone said the possibility of North Territorial Road too, although generally trucks that of that size try and stay off roads that precarious, that windy, that narrow.
Roads are already bad enough
without
heavy traffic.
Yes, sir, you're right. Yes, sir, you're right. Is there anything else that I can assist you with this evening? This has been wonderful being here. It always is. I look forward to this every year. Yes, ma'am.
Is this the only presentation that you're making of the state of the city at this place, or do you do this other places? Just curious.
We try to alternate back and forth each year. It's usually the Thursday right after Veterans Day, but I was in Boston for that day. On the 13th, I was in Boston all day and all evening. So I'm giving it to you this evening, and we normally go back and forth between here and the beautiful facility at Silver Maples. And it's simply because of the, we try and work back and forth.
We don't have any other residents than old people who come to these stairs, you know, mostly old people.
Well, we could. I think it's bridge night here. That's normally, this room is much more filled than this. At Silver Maples, I get a good turnout.
Of city residents.
Yes. I think your question is, why aren't there more concerned citizens here to hear the State of the City address? Okay, good for you. I wondered that my first year myself when I did this. I can tell you that almost everyone who serves at any level in this town or that lives in this town is actively engaged in life, usually with children, school, that type of thing. And on a Thursday night at 7 o'clock in mid-November, probably other places they want to be. Frankly, I'm frustrated and embarrassed that there aren't more people here myself, but that's just, it's part of raising your right hand. Sir, you had a question. How are you? Yes, sir, how are you?
Am I next?
You are, sir.
In regards to the mine again.
Yes.
Is that land privately owned or is it state owned or who owns that property?
Forgive me, is the land privately owned? Is that what you said? Okay, the gentleman asked about the type of ownership of the property that's being considered for purchase for mining operations. It's my understanding it is privately owned by an entity which is a living trust, a family's living trust at the moment, or the majority of that land is owned by a trust. It's not owned by a living, breathing entity at this time. Does that answer the question? All right, good. The reason I'm here tonight, and I was here last November, is we had the evening of civil discourse at Silver Maples in July. So I try and get back and forth to as many different spots as as possible. Good. I've so enjoyed being here. I always do. I look forward to this every year. Thank you so much for coming this evening and for your great questions. I learned a lot. Thank you very much. Good night.